and stay standing. Those of you who are watching online, we decided to start this morning with prayer because there are so many who are hurting in their body today, who are healing, who need healing in their body. Yes, we started already. There's family members in other states that need healing. And so we just wanted to believe this morning before we started as a group. We've got those who still are out sick. And so instead of growing numbers, we've been dwindling every week because of sickness. But we believe that God is still in the healing business. Amen. Amen. So let's go ahead and start this morning by praising the Lord.
There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know everything I need you got. There's honey in the rock. Pray for a miracle, thirsty for the living well. Only you can satisfy. Sweetness at the mercy seat. Now I've tasted, it's not hard to see. Only you can satisfy. There's honey in the rock. There's honey in the rock. There's honey in the rock. There's honey in the rock.
I like this right here.
Freedom where the spirit is, bounty in the wilderness, you will always satisfy. There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry, now that I know everything I need you got. There's honey in the rock. Power in the blood, healing in your hands. Started going when you said it is done. Everything you did is enough. But I keep looking, I keep finding. You keep giving, keep providing. I have all that I need. You are all that I need. I keep praying, you keep moving. I keep praising, you keep proving. I have all that I need. You are all that I need. I keep looking, I keep finding. You keep giving, keep providing. You are all that I need. You are all that I need. I keep praying, you keep moving. Keep praising, you keep proving. I have all that I need. You are all that I need. I have all that I need. You are all that I need. Yeah. There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. In the blood, healing in your hand, started flowing when you said it is done. Jesus, who you are, is enough. There's honey in the rock, yeah, honey in the rock. There's honey in the rock, there's honey in the rock. Sweet it is to trust in you, Jesus. Oh, how sweet it is to trust in you, Jesus. Oh, how sweet to trust in you, Jesus.
Isn't it? Amen. Amen. Proverbs 3 says, my son or daughter, do not forget my law, but let your heart keep my commands. For length of days and long life and peace they will add to you. Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart, and lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he is going to direct your path. Amen? Come on, let's sing this together.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord.
Come on, sing it out this morning.
We'll be right back. to the very end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him. How I proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. God, we love you. God, we worship you this morning. In sickness and in health, we worship you. As I walked through the door, I sensed His presence. And I knew this was the place where love abounds, for this is the temple, Jehovah God, He abides here. Yes, He does. And I'm so glad we are standing in His presence on holy ground. I know my God is
This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is here, and where he is holy. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is here, and where he is holy. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can feel the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. And I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. We are standing in his presence. This is holy ground. Aren't you thankful for his presence in this very room this morning? There's nothing like the presence of the Lord. Come on and minister Jesus to us this morning. You can be seated.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let us praise Jesus now. Stand in his presence on holy ground. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Isn't it wonderful that he has made us holy so that we can be in his presence that is holy? Amen. We always have to recognize when it's the Lord's presence that is here. Praise God. You know, in these days that we live, we have to remember what Paul says in Ephesians beginning in chapter 6, verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the power of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm. You do everything you can to stand. You just stand firm. Uh, stand firm with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, the confidence that we are the righteousness of Christ. The devil comes against that. He challenges that every day. But the breastplate of righteousness, say to yourself, I am the righteousness of Christ. Say it. I am the righteousness of Christ. And with your feet, with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace, in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith. The shield of faith. We need more faith. God doesn't need more power. We need more faith. We need to be like the woman with the issue of blood that reached out and said, if I can just get to Jesus and touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed. Jesus was looking for those who had faith. Our faith is challenged in this world of doubt and fear and the naysayers that are probably 10 to 1 that say, God can't do that. God doesn't do that anymore. God doesn't even exist. But we believe, and we have that faith. Oh, for grace to trust him more. We need the gift of faith. He even gives us a gift of faith. We don't even have to well it up within us. He says, just pray the gift. When we get to the gifts of the Spirit, one of the gifts of the Spirit is the gift of faith. The Holy Spirit can give us the faith that we need to believe him for what he wants to do today. Take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. This is why it is so important that we are studying the Word of God and know the Word of God, because it is our offense. It's the only offensive weapon in the armor. It is what we use against the enemy. What does it say in Revelation? It says, they overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of his testimony. Too many don't know the Word of God today, so their sword is dull. Their sword is chipped off. It has no power. It has no authority because it won't work, because it's not sharp. But the Bible says the Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. The Word of God is powerful. And so that's why the Lord keeps telling us, get in my Word. Meditate on my word day and night. Without it, you are powerless. You have the armor, but you don't have the offense. You don't have the weapon to rule and to take authority over the devil, over anything that comes against us. The Word of God is the only thing. My word means absolutely nothing. Your word means absolutely nothing. His word is powerful. His word divides bone and marrow. His word cuts through any untruth, any attack. And when we stand against the enemy, we resist the devil, he will flee. I don't even have to fight him. The Bible never says I need to get to punch and match with the devil. All I need to do is hold up that sword and say, here's the sword of truth. Get thee behind me. And he has to flee. Oh, but we give the devil so much power. He's so powerful. He's got all these minions. Well, It's 3 to 1 as far as I can calculate. A third of the angels fell with Satan, who is least powerful not even powerful as God. And we've got angels all around us. I feel the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. We don't have to worry about the devil and the demons when we are surrounded by the angels and the Almighty God, and we have the sword of truth. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints, praying for each other. When we pray for each other, you see how it works. When we pray for each other, a fresh anointing comes in. When all we're concerned about is our own needs and our own requests, it's all right. But when we pray for others, God hears us. God knows that we are preferring one another above ourselves. And then pray for me also, that whenever I open my mouth, words may be given to me, that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly, as I should. And we pray for each other, that we have opportunity, that we have the ability to be bold in our witness, to be bold and confident in our witness. But first, we have to be covered with that armor and hold that sword of the Spirit. Amen? Amen. Well, that was just something that the Lord laid on my heart to share with us this morning, as we are all dealing with attacks, dealing with different struggles of doubt and fear. You know, there's no place for fear. There's no place for fear. There is no fear in love, the Bible says, that we can be confident in the Lord. I want to talk about, believe it or not, we have our discussion about divine healing today. And and we won't be long today. I know a lot of you are concerned about other things that are going on, and let me get to the right page here. All right. So we've been talking about the ministry. Last week we talked about the ministry. There are four aspects of our ministry to evangelize the world. It's part of our worship of God, building a body of saints, being perfected in the image of His Son, meeting human need with ministries of love and compassion. I think the most important scripture we should always have is James chapter 1, verse 27, is religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. We work hard trying to build a church, but the Lord looks at us as to how we are touching other people's lives, how we are ministering to other people. It doesn't matter if there's 1,000 of us or 10 of us. If we are doing what the Lord has asked us to do, He will bless us. And I appreciate so much your faithfulness each and every week. After all these years that we've been doing this, that you've been faithful to God, and that we are learning to be a loving group of people that love those. I just love when someone comes in and we all hug on them and we welcome them, and that's so wonderful. But that should be our lifestyle. That should be our ministry in the world today. That it's nice to be nice to the nice. Did you ever watch MASH? Frank Burns used to say that. It's nice to be nice to the nice. Well, it is. But even the heathen, the Bible says, do that. Even the pagans can do that. It's another thing to be nice to those that are not nice, to those that are un lovable, those that are not up to our standards, but they are up to the Lord's standards. The Lord cares about the lowest of lowest and highest of highest. He says, when you've done it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. And we have to continue to remember those things. Just even if in our interactions with the world and those around us, if we show love and appreciation to those that we come in contact with, our religion is accepted by the Lord and is faultless. And I believe that growth will come if we act accordingly outside of these walls, outside of this place. We have to make the Lord pleased with who we are as individuals. So we move on to divine healing. Divine healing is an integral part of the gospel. Deliverance from sickness is provided for in the atonement and is the privilege of all believers. Praise the Lord. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 4 and 5. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. Matthew chapter 8, verse 16 and 17 says, when evening came, many who were demon-possessed were brought to him, and he drove out the spirits with a word and healed all the sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah. He took our infirmities and bore our diseases. Now let me just say a word about him driving out the spirits. The spirits fled at the power of God. They didn't have to be wrestled with. They didn't have to be convinced by Jesus to get out. They said, what are you going to do with us, Lord? Send us over to the pigs. They knew that they had to go when the presence of God was there. This business of toiling and arguing with demons for hours and hours and hours is not what Jesus did, not what the disciples did. They, full of the Holy Spirit, said, go, and they had to go. They have to go at the power of Jesus. And he took our infirmities and bore our diseases. Now, in James chapter 5, and this is what we did this morning. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith, there's the word faith again. The prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. This is such an important element. We need to, before we ever pray for someone's healing, before we ever pray for our own healing, we need to pray for faith. We need to pray for that faith that just believes that this is just the way it's going to be. And just like we've talked about before, the centurion and his servant, please just heal my servant. Oh, I'll come with you to your house. No, I'm not worthy for you to come to my house. Just say the word. And Jesus said, I have not seen any faith this strong in all of Israel. And he wasn't even an Israelite. The faith that we have to have just to believe it's going to happen. It's just, you know, we've had disappointments in our lives. We've had times that we've prayed and we haven't seen what we need to see. And there may be a reason for that, but there may be a lack of faith on our part and a bit of doubt that comes in. Doubt is not part of the Spirit of God. Doubt is not a gift of the Spirit. There's boldness, there's faith, there's all those wonderful gifts, but doubt is not among them. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well, and the Lord will raise them up. Now, this is important, too. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. How many times did Jesus say, you're forgiven while he's healing? Healing and forgiveness have to go hand in hand. What good is it for us to pray for someone to be healed if they're not forgiven, if they're not in a relationship with Jesus Christ? So they go on living in sin? That's not part of the plan. Part of the plan is salvation, coming to Christ and coming to faith and believing in God, and then healing comes. They said, if they have sinned, they will be forgiven. And then this is the word to the elders. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. If we are hiding sin, if we have secret sin, if we have, you know, the things, the attitudes of our hearts, the things in our life that are displeasing to the Lord can't use us in faith to touch other people's lives unless we confess those sins, unless we say to the Lord, Lord, I am having a problem in this area. This is my sin. I admit it. I confess it to you. I say to you, this is wrong. I'm not going to accept this in my life anymore, whatever it may be. I think for a lot of us that have been raised in the church our whole lives, it's not a blatant, sin. It's more the sin of the heart. It's a sin of the attitude. It's a sin of the way we look at things in our lives, and maybe our judgmentalness, and maybe those things that the Lord says are not pleasing to him, but we hang on to him and we think, well, that's okay. I'm allowed. And we have to say to ourselves and say to the Lord, is this allowed? Is this allowed? And that comes again from studying the Word of God and accepting it and knowing that it's the truth. We have a lot of tradition that we add to Scripture. Our traditions that we add to the Scripture, and that gets us in some trouble sometimes, because unless the Word of God says it's right, it's wrong. There were years ago when I was growing up that you ladies would be sinners today. The way you look. How dare you wear makeup? How dare you show your knees? How dare you put on jewelry? You are a sinner. Okay? That's not in the Bible. That it was a tradition. And a tradition sometimes can go too far. And now there are churches that still say, no makeup, no this, it's a sin. Well, what does the Bible say? The Bible says that God judges your heart. God judges the holiness of your heart. That you shouldn't worry about your outward appearance, but and try to impress people with your outward appearance. Doesn't mean you can't look nice. It means that your heart is what should be your crown and glory. And that's what's most important to God. Man looks on the outward, but God looks on the heart. And so we have to be very careful about the traditions that we bring to the Word of God. And it sometimes can lead us in the wrong direction. And I encourage anybody, if we do things that we think are right, but that maybe the doctrines that I've shared, the things that we have in our fundamental truths, maybe come in conflict with that, study the Word. find the word that says, this tradition, this thing that I do is found in the Word of God. Now, when it comes to healing, I believe there are several ways that God heals. I believe that God heals instantly, instantaneously. We see it in the Bible. I've seen it in my own life. I've seen where God just, we pray and God heals. And I believe that's the kind of faith we just need to have. Just, there's no other option. There's no other way out. God, I'm believing for divine healing right now. I'm believing for a turnaround. I also believe that God uses medicine. God uses the doctors. God uses our own bodies, that he's given us healing power in our bodies. I've scraped myself up, cut myself up, bruised myself up in our move, had my back strained to where I could barely walk during it, making Renee move all the boxes while I sat on the heating pad. Maybe that was just a little excuse, but no. No, it was just terrible. But with a little ice, a little prayer, a little heat that God gave me has healing power in it. The wounds heal. The bruises go away. There's healing that he's given us in our own bodies. Any living thing heals. It can heal itself. You go scrape up a tree, it'll scar up, but it'll stay alive. It'll heal itself. I believe that's one way of healing. There's another way of healing, and that is the divine healing, the ultimate blessed hope. You know, I was telling Lynn maybe a couple weeks ago, Elijah was caught up in a chariot of fire. Elisha died of an illness. I don't know why. Elisha wanted a double portion of the Holy Spirit, a double portion of the anointing. But God's plan and purpose for our lives is that we're going to die. We're going to die. And that is gain, the Bible says. That is gain. That is the ultimate and the blessed hope. The blessed hope is the resurrection of those who have fallen asleep in Christ and their translation together with those who are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord is the imminent and blessed hope of the church. We do not mourn as those who have no hope. Lynn, your mom, we're going to see her again when we rise again. The Bible says in First Thessalonians 4:16-17, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a loud command and the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ, they get to go first. They will go first. After that, we who are still alive and left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so will we be with the Lord forever. How great is that going to be? We're talking about no more sickness, no more pain, no more mourning. It's going to be joy and gladness and the presence of God. We sitting here and singing, we are standing on holy ground. Imagine what it's going to be like when we stand before in the presence of the Lord on his holy ground, on his holy streets, the streets of gold, where asphalt is not used, but pure gold is used for the streets. That is our blessed hope. That is an ultimate healing. And so we believe for divine immediate healing. We believe that medicine and our own bodies can heal, and the Lord can use that. But we also know that the dead in Christ will rise first, and we which are alive and remain. I'd like to be alive and remain. That would be nice. You know, the whole idea of passing and going to sleep in this world and dying here is a creepy thing for us to think about, caskets and funerals and all that kind of stuff. But the Bible says, precious, precious in the eyes of the Lord is the death of one of his saints. Marcia, your husband, waiting for us. We're going to join together someday soon. All those loved ones that are waiting in that great cloud of witnesses, they're saying, keep the faith. Keep the faith. Don't lose out on the last leg of the race. You're going to make it. We made it. We're cheering you on. And they are waiting for us. And may the Lord grant us his grace and mercy to make it through, to keep our eye on the prize, and to keep running our race in faith and believe that that day is coming. It could come anytime. There is nothing in Scripture that needs to be fulfilled before the rapture of the church. The only thing holding it back is the Lord's grace and mercy for the lost and the dying. And that's why we have to have that same passion, that same compassion for the lost and the dying. We need to get up every morning and say, Lord, save that last one so that we can be with you. Reach that last one so that we can be with you. Send that missionary to that place, that remote location, Lord, so that we can wrap this up and be with you. Amen? That really needs to be our prayer. Boy, we have a lot to pray about. We have a lot to pray about. You think we don't have a lot to pray about? And we spend so much time praying, Lord, help me with this. Help me get through this. Help me get through my day. Help me with this deal and with that deal. And Lord, help me with my job and with my family. And the real thing he's saying is pray the prayer of faith. Pray for more faith. Pray for more trust. Pray that souls would be saved. Pray that I would be bold and have opportunity to share the love of Christ to those around me. And that will bring what we are all looking forward to, the Lord's coming. I think I could sing this song. What a healing Jesus I found in you. What a healing Jesus. He'll restore, refresh, and renew. What a healing Jesus. For such a time as this, arise on healing wings, songs of righteousness. One more time. What a healing Jesus I found in you. What a healing Jesus. He'll restore, refresh, and renew. What a healing Jesus. For such a time as this, arise on healing wings, songs of righteousness. Oh, there's healing in his wings. song says, under his wings I am safely abiding. May we stay close to him. May we stay in his presence. May we stay connected to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, our only hope of salvation, of healing, of righteousness is in our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise his name. Can we just praise him a moment? Hallelujah, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We lift up songs of righteousness, Lord, to you, Lord. We thank you for all your goodness, for the goodness that you've given us, for the goodness and faithfulness you've given us. Lord, when so many around this world are suffering, and we have so many blessings, Lord, may we use those blessings to praise you, to lift up your name, and to further your kingdom. We pray in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. And you shall go out with joy and be led forth with joy.